Let me start it.
Yes.
Good evening, all law students and legal professionals who have joined with us in this webinar lecture series presented by Legal Trendsetter on the topic Sexual Harassment by Geeta Luther Ma'am. Geeta Luther Ma'am is designated as senior advocate. He has been practicing in the Supreme Court, the Delhi High Court, and the various High Court. She's the Vice President of the Indian Council of Arbitration, member of Indian Chapter Core Committee. She is also a member of a Women White Collar Defense Association. She was awarded a prestigious foundation scholarship for a law at a Cambridge, where pursued LLM and MPhil in the international. She is currently Advocate General of State of Haryana and a senior counsel for a Union of India and the Supreme Court. Ma'am has landmark judgment in the various fields, has successfully defended the right of several members of society, including women, children, and transgender. She's also been a lead counsel in a landmark arbitration and land acquisition matter. Ma'am, now is up to you. Please join.
Good evening, everyone. It's a pleasure to be here, and it's a pleasure to be speaking to all of you. The subject that we are speaking on today is sexual harassment at the workplace. Jawaharlal Nehru, the first Prime Minister of India, said, "You can tell the condition of a nation by looking at the status of its women." Let me first tell you that in India, women have been leaders in all walks of life. And we have a great disparity in India of the status of women. There are women who are performing well, who are Supreme Court judges, High Court judges, the Prime Minister of India, late Mrs. Indira Gandhi, was a woman. We've had a woman president, and we have had a president of India who is a woman. So we've had women in all walks of life. At present, we have the finance minister, who is a woman, Nirmala Sitharaman. So our women have been acknowledged, have been given position of power. Let me also say this, that long ago, Professor Lasky and Lord Acton have said that economic power is the handmaid of political power. Economic empowerment of women goes hand in hand with political empowerment. The topic sexual harassment at the workplace is very topical and concerns all of us. If women have to live with dignity, if they have to work with dignity, they have to have a free environment, a non-hostile environment, a friendly environment where they will achieve greater heights and do very well. For all young boys and girls and those who are attending the lecture, I want to say that our lives begin to end the day we become silent about things that matter. Sexual harassment is a form of discrimination. It has nothing to do with a person's physical attraction. When we do work in the workplace, we have to ensure that women are respected. They have a place where they can work in a free environment. When there is a quid pro quo for getting favors or giving favors, allowing a person to work, it is at that time that you can say that there is sexual harassment at the workplace. Men may think that certain jokes, certain innuendos are something which is a backslapping issue where someone may make a comment about a woman's looks, a woman's style, a woman's way of dressing. But those innuendos are not simple. They affect a woman and they affect the manner in which she will perform. Very frequently, people in the workplace may actually touch a woman unrequired, unwantedly, and that is an act of sexual harassment. They may not touch, they may make statements. They may not make statements, they may make glances which are inappropriate. All that has now been enacted in law. We already had an enactment outraging the modesty of a woman under Section 354. After Nirbhay's case in 2012, far-reaching amendments with regard to sexual abuse, sexual harassment were made. Voyeurism, speaking of a woman, looking at a woman inappropriately, all became acts of sexual harassment. Now there will be acts which are not related to a woman as a woman, but as a worker in a space. They do not become sexual harassment just because she is in the workplace. They will become acts of sexual harassment if it is addressing her as a woman and not as a person. And I will go on to distinguish how certain acts, which may, even though said to a woman, may not be intended to be acts of sexual harassment. It was in 1996 that, as a result of Bhavri Devi's case, which came to the Supreme Court, that sexual harassment at the workplace, which was recognized in accordance with the CEDAW Convention. The Convention for Elimination of Discrimination Against Women was ratified by India, but had come into force in 1979. It was in 1996-1997 that Justice J.S. Verma and Justice B.N. Kirpal of the Supreme Court laid down the parameters in terms of the CEDAW Convention, to which India perhaps was a signatory in 1994. And in accordance with that, what it said was that in the workplace, there will be a complaints committee. So there are two kinds of committee. One, there should be a committee in the workplace. The second is there should be a local complaints committee for those organizations which do not have a committee at the workplace. The manner of giving complaints should be extremely fast. There should be a statutory committee existing. Committee is to consist of four members. In 2013, the Sexual Harassment, the POSH Act, Prevention of Sexual Harassment Act, came into being. And that has various provisions, which include in having on the committee two people who are involved in human rights. The Delhi High Court has said that a committee which is set up should be in accordance with the enactment and earlier in accordance with Vishakha's guidelines. Now, even though this enactment was there, it was only much later that we started having these committees, and even now the implementation of these in terms of Medha Kotwal's judgment is being foreseen, is being overlooked rather, overseen by the Supreme Court in what is known as Medha Kotwal. The case comes up time to time, grievances are made, they are redressed, they are looked at. Very many years ago, I had appeared in a matter where we were objecting to a sexual harassment committee set up, which committee was inferior or junior to the person who was the head of the institute against whom allegations of sexual harassment were made. Now let's look at this. What's the point of having a committee which will not be of independent people, equivalent people, people who are able to dictate, who are able not to dictate, who are able to have an independent thought process, and who are not dictated by the head of the institute or the principal of the institute. So sexual harassment is all pervasive. We must remember it is a gender sensitive act. It's not a gender neutral act. 5% of men may face sexual harassment at the workplace, but this enactment is not addressed to them. There will be one member from an NGO, there will be two members from among employees, preferably women who are in either social work or in the legal field. The Internal Complaints Committee under the POSH plays a very laudatory role, because once you already have a committee in place, then the redressal will be much quicker. If a person makes a complaint and one of these matters came to the Supreme Court, it is she, in fact, in one of the cases which came from Indore, this person who was transferred to another place, and she raised a grievance that she should not be transferred. It is the accused against whom she's making allegations who should be transferred. The law provides for that the woman may choose to be transferred out of that workplace to another office, or she may say that person who is an accused may be transferred. Now, the ICC, any complaint to the ICC has to be made within 3 months. Again, there is a judgment of the Delhi High Court which says this 3-month period can be extended to 6 months. Of course, there need to be explanations. If a complaint has to be genuine, it has to be done with expedition. So it is 3 months from the last incident of sexual harassment. Now, this time period is very material because it will get rid of what may be false complaints. There will be cases of false complaints. A person may be an ad hoc employee. a person may not be coming to work in time. And then when she feels that she may be terminated, or her services will not be confirmed, or her probation period will be extended, she may file a false complaint. The law has to envisage that if there are false complaints, such complaints are not entertained, and there is action taken in case of false complaint is filed. Many women's groups have said that this would actually make women more cautious in making complaints, make them scared to make complaints, because the repercussions on it will be very penal. So we have sexual harassment complaints being filed against employers, against serious people, senior people in the employment, those who would be in a position to control the manner in which the committee would take course. However, we have to be cautious that the complaints which are entertained are such that they are not vexatious or malicious or fraudulent. So the law has to give women a hostile-free environment, an environment which is friendly, an environment which is open, environment in which she flourishes, does well, and yet it should not be an environment which will stifle people with whom they are working. We have to be careful that false complaints do not get accepted without any verification, without any evidence. The other question is, what is a workplace? Today, many people are working from home. Would that entitle an employer to make innuendos? Would that entitle an employer to be abusive? Would that entitle a person to say, this is not strictly speaking a workplace, you're working from home, if I am talking about you with sexual innuendos, this will not be a workplace? This is incorrect. Even if you go out to work, if you are out of station for work, if you are staying in a hotel for work, that workplace will extend to that. Thus, 2O of the Act gives an extended definition of workplace. Now, in a case which was decided in 2008 in the Office of Auditor General of India, a person made a complaint where the lady was teased or misbehaved with in the official mess. And the defense was, this was a mess, it was not the workplace. But that was an official mess and the misconduct took place there. The courts extended the definition and said that this amounts to a workplace. What if one is doing a business conference on video conferencing? What if it's work from home and a person uses that concept to make statements, sexually colored remarks to the woman? That again amounts to a workplace. in an outstation matter, as I said just now, in 2015 in Gaurav Jain, the Delhi High Court said that if you go out of town, you're staying in a hotel, but you are having a outstation visit, would that amount to a workplace if your co-worker or your senior or superior misbehaves, misconducts himself with you? That has been held to be a workplace also. So if we look at the law of what is a workplace, we will see that the law's definition, because this is a beneficial legislation, the law has given an extremely wide interpretation. In a High Court judgment of the Bombay High Court, members of ICC, being simple employees, not trained in social work, not being lawyers, not being experienced, the court said that this does not amount to workplace. Now, in schools, colleges, academic institutions, sexual harassment has been rampant because teachers have a position of giving marks, professors have to give papers, they will correct papers, they will have a control over your career, over how you function. The petitioner in one case of B.N. Ray was teaching in Ramjas College in Delhi University and took over as vice principal. The question that was raised was, what is the principle of natural justice? Is he entitled to have? And I remember a similar case of JNU, where an internal complaints committee was sitting. And one of the aspects the internal complaints committee said that previous complaints, details of statements would not be supplied to the accused. Now that also is violative of principles of natural justice. Person is told you cross-examine in the air. But if he doesn't know the case against him, if he doesn't know that he is deemed to have misbehaved or teased or made sexually colored remarks to a person on Tuesday, the 10th of November, 2020, how does he ask questions? How does he prove his presence? How does he show presence of witnesses which will deny the allegations? So both parties have a right to bring witnesses. Both parties have a right to cross-examine each other. However, you have to make sure that the girl is not embarrassed. The girl does not feel humiliated. Otherwise, other women who may have similar complaints against the same person or another person would not be ready to speak up, would not be ready to make a complaint. This is why principles of natural justice, while taking into account the sensitivity of a person who is the complainant, taking into account that she should not be humiliated or embarrassed, that the line of cross-examination should not go beyond boundaries, should be preserved. Some courts have held that the ICC would not allow the victim, similar to POXO cases, to be seen by the accused when the accused is cross-examining the person. the victim. Now, these are adult victims. They are not minor victims. So I believe that conditions paramateria to POCSO should not apply, but the committee has to be careful that the person does not feel harassed or abused. Now, in sexual harassment at the workplace, the enactment that is there is extremely well placed, is extremely wide. So we in India have law which is at par with other countries of the world. The only question is, how far is it being implemented? And do you have, apart from civil and disciplinary remedies, do you have criminal remedies? So to my mind, criminal remedies under 354, 354 A, B, C, etc. onwards, 509 IPC, are provisions which can be looked at. In the US, there have been several cases, and I am talking from the last more than 100 years, where people have felt harassed at the workplace. There was a lady working in the shipyard. Men had put up posters which were slightly obscene, which were offensive to the sensibilities of a woman, and the courts held that that was sexual harassment at the workplace, that such posters are put up in a workplace where women will also be coming to work. In the case of a bank in the US Supreme Court, there was another case where a person, a lady, was being raped repeatedly. And her argument, after some days, she stopped coming to work. Her argument was that she was harassed so much that she could not continue to take the insult. But the bank manager or the senior officer in the bank continued to harass, abuse, rape her, have sexual relations with her against her wishes, on the ground of allowing her to continue to work. The trial court, lower courts, held that this abuse, this harassment was not a harassment, because why would for so many years she continue to have relations with such a manager in case it was not consensual? In this case, it's Meritor is the name of the case. In this case, finally, the courts held, when the matter went to the higher courts, that this was sexual harassment. The very fact that the woman did not want the advances, did not want the sexual relations, and discontinued her work would not deny her or entitle the employer to get her dismissed. On the other hand, she was entitled to continue to work in the place, and it is the employer or the manager who would be punished and tried and prosecuted for sexual harassment or misconduct in the workplace. So some kinds, I want to tell you some kinds of sexual stereotyping, which is done with regard to women. Statements are made, she does not belong to the workplace. She does not belong to the job. She is taking the place of a man who needs the job, who needs to feed his family. She is being paid more than a woman should earn. She is doing this job just to find a husband. Such were and are sometimes, even in today, the allegations that may be made to make the environment even more hostile than it is to a woman. The effect of pornography in the workplace has been treated in a similar manner. The Supreme Court has laid down directions, firstly in Vishakha, then in Medha Kotwal, which started 1 year after Vishakha, but which continues, and there are directions given even from time to time, even now. In Sima Lepcha versus the state of Sikkim in 2013 Supreme Court, the court said that white publicity has to be given to this. Women should know that they have a means of redressal. Women should know that where they have to go, where is the box or the letterbox where she can give a complaint? Who is the person to whom she can give a complaint? How she can give a complaint? Doordarshan, every month, publicity has to be given in Doordarshan. Legal Services Authority should come to train people, to educate people, to create awareness in people. A very interesting case, which I had adverted to earlier, this case of Anil Rajagopal versus state of Kerala. Petitioner had some grievances. He was a man. He was a program coordinator, and he felt that some of the important material had been taken away by a lady. And he used the word that the material has been abducted by this lady for his purpose of his giving a report. The lady made a sexual harassment complaint. Now, was it sexual harassment if someone, employer, employee, an employee or a co-worker who has removed some important papers? Now, her sex was not material to the complaint, nor did he complain to her about her or make remarks about her as if she was a woman. She was just a co-worker, a co-employee, a co-colleague who was working under him and who had taken away papers. Now, when she filed a complaint, that complaint was dismissed. It was held that there was no allegation which constituted sexual harassment. There is also a side statement, which is a solitary allegation of intemperate language against a female colleague, does not constitute an offense under the Prevention of Sexual Harassment Act. Now, to some extent, one man's meat is another man's poison. So what may be offensive to a lady may not appear to be offensive to her colleagues. Now, if it is not offensive to her colleagues, but if it affects the sensibilities of the woman as a woman, would it amount to sexual harassment? The answer is, it does amount to sexual harassment. Now, how do you approach for protection? You can approach for protection. You can make sure that the person does not come near you. You can make sure that the person to whom you are answerable is different. You can ask for your team to be changed. You can ask for a transfer. You can ask for a person to be transferred. Now, these are some aspects of sexual harassment at the workplace. Sexual harassment in order for it to become reduced or obliterated in society, all the co-workers have to assist. Suppose a woman files a complaint, but no male or female colleague who is a co-worker who has seen the harassment she has faced come forward to give evidence, then the likelihood is that she may not succeed in her case. So, in order to prevent that, it is most important that civil society also cooperates in every way, and they assist the woman in order to ensure that this malaise which exists in society, where people believe that just because they are more powerful or they are senior to their colleague, they would be able to do acts of sexual harassment. Sexual harassment affects the dignity of a woman. It has a devastating effect on her mind, body, and soul. It affects the right to privacy of a person and the right to your bodily integrity. And it is for this reason that we have to ensure that sexual harassment in every way is redressed by the work environment at once, and that anyone who is a witness to it should see that it is stemmed in the bud and is not allowed to continue. In the Supreme Court judgment of Justice Puthuswamy versus Union of India 2017 Supreme Court, this right to live with dignity has been given great importance. Right to live includes right to live with dignity, includes right to nobody having the temerity to make statements which are sexually colored, make conduct which is sexually colored, to be offensive, to not give women an environment which is free and which allows them to grow as human beings. So it's also an integral part of the right to life. And with this, let me end my talk by saying that sexual harassment at the workplace, when more and more women are working, has no place in a society which wants its women to flourish and to progress.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much. Ma'am, there is a question. Ma'am, she want to ask that the recent judgment of the Mumbai High Court with regard to explaining sexual harassment will rise in the case of sexual harassment and create a chaos in a society.
Yes. So the recent judgment of the Mumbai High Court, Nagpur bench, is a judgment which has defined sexual assault. It says in para 18 that the definition of sexual assault in the POCSO Act is a definition which talks of physical contact and talks about touch. The court has interpreted touch as skin to skin contact and physical contact as skin to skin contact. Now, this definition is pedantic, is narrow, is contrary to the purpose of a beneficial legislation. However, to the best of my knowledge, and in this case, there was groping of a girl child from outside her clothes. And the issue was that should there be a skin-to-skin touch? And the court said, yes, it is required for it to amount to sexual assault. There are no known Indian judgments on this. Groping is an act of sexual assault. But this argument made of skin-to-skin touch was made in this case. There are a few English judgments on this issue, and they have said that it need not be a skin-to-skin touch to amount to sexual assault. The challenge in the Supreme Court, National Commission for Women have also challenged it. The Attorney General of India, K.K. Venugopal, has in a suo motu mentioned it, and notice has been issued. The other petitions are coming up on the 8th of February. And the interpretation that it need not be skin to skin touch has been specifically put in many of the American statutes. I believe 49 out of the 50 states have clarified this so that there is no ambiguity. New Mexico is the only state that has not clarified this and has referred to perhaps as skin to skin touch. So it's a judgment which we hope will be overturned, but the law does not seem to have pronounced on this on an earlier occasion.
What about the people who belong to transgender society? They are being harassed by the people because of their gender rather than sexually.
So, this is a difficult question, and it's a very moot question. Transgender people are being subject to harassment and abuse frequently. Since this is a gender-sensitive act, it has not taken into account transgenders. However, the law should take them into account, and there is, according to me, a crying need for that. However, there are this aspect of law may need some amendments, some new description, because ultimately the right of bodily integrity of every individual is important, man, woman, or of any other gender. And that's why it needs to be incorporated. But I don't believe that it has yet been incorporated or interpreted.
What about in the case of male? There is any also such act?
So there are many enactments in India, I think some 42 or 46, which are gender non-gender neutral, which are gender specific and are protecting only women. Law under section 498A IPC demanding dowry from a woman, killing or murdering a woman because of dowry demands. All these are gender sensitive and gender specific enactments. If it's a man, he does not have relief under these enactments. I believe that even if what the statistics appear to say is there are 5% of men who suffer from sexual harassment at the workplace, I believe that there should be a mechanism for redressal for them also.
Husband and wife working in the same company and husband passes a sexual comment on his wife in a workplace, can a wife file a suit under a post? It will be amount to sexual harassment?
Between husband and wife, I wonder, because it is with consent of each other that you perform sexual acts. Even in rape law, there cannot be rape by a married man of his wife. So marital rape has yet to be introduced under the Indian Penal Code in the statute book. So a sexually colored remark to your wife may not be treated as being offensive or part and parcel of the POSH Act.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much. Thank you for giving a valuable time. Thank you so much, ma'am.
You're welcome.
Thank you, ma'am.
I hope you enjoyed it.
Yes, ma'am.